Hello students, as you know, we are lacking with the syllabus, so I have decided to take some classes online, I mean through the videos which I'll be uploading in the YouTube, and the videos are actually bigger one, so you cannot download them. For that reason I'm putting it in the YouTube so that you can watch it whenever you need, and make sure that you use a pen, paper or a book when you watch the lecture or the class. I'll be making small videos so that you don't get bored. The small videos, not more than 10 or 15 minutes, okay, and then you can proceed with your usual work, okay. And mostly I'll be putting the video every day, so 15 minutes per video, okay. Hope this will be helpful to you. Thank you. Well, to begin with the introduction of what phenylalanine and tyrosine are. Basically, alanine is C double bond OOH, that is carboxylic group, and NH2. This is glycine. If it has C, it is alanine. And if this C has a phenyl group, it is called phenylalanine. What is it? This is alanine group and phenyl group is attached to it, so it is phenylalanine. Another structure to remember is there is nothing difference between phenylalanine and tyrosine except one functionality, and that is this is phenylalanine. Right, and if there is OH, that is hydroxy group, the fourth position is called tyrosine. Okay, these two are the structurally related amino acids, and moreover it has aromatic ring, both of them has aromatic ring, so it is aromatic amino acids. Okay, and phenylalanine is essential amino acid, whereas this one is non-essential amino acid. Okay, and what happens is in a protein, as you know, proteins are the building blocks of amino acids. Protein has phenylalanine. This phenylalanine gets converted to tyrosine and shows its function. So basically phenylalanine function is to get converted to tyrosine and then show its activity, and for this reason it is also called as sparing action of tyrosine on phenylalanine. So this is not a matter. Okay, moving on, what happens is these two are responsible, or instead of saying these two, I would say tyrosine is responsible to synthesize different compounds or hormones such as epinephrine. I hope it is visible to you. Epinephrine, norepinephrine, dopamine, and thyroid hormones. And you know what thyroid hormones are, that is T3 and T4. And one more thing, it is also responsible to synthesize the colored pigment in human beings, and that is melanin. Okay, I hope this is clear to you. We'll just make a recap. Phenylalanine and tyrosine are the aromatic amino acids. Okay, phenylalanine gets converted to tyrosine. Okay, this tyrosine shows activities. The function of phenylalanine is to get converted to tyrosine and shows its activity. So tyrosine is responsible to synthesize hormones such as epinephrine, norepinephrine, dopamine, thyroid hormones, and melanin. I hope it is clear to you. And these
These amino acids are responsible to form glucose and fat. Okay, this produces glucose and fat. Hence, it is also called, hence the tyrosine can also be as glucogenic amino acid as well as ketogenic amino acid. You know, to synthesize glucose we need tyrosine here, and whereas to synthesize fat we need ketone bodies, right? So in the metabolism you will be seeing how the amino group is getting transferred, which is transamination reaction, and you will get to know how it is responsible to synthesize fat and how it is going to synthesize glucose. Till here I think it's clear. Shall we do a recap? Yes, we'll do it. Phenylalanine and tyrosine are the aromatic amino acids, okay, and this is essential and this is non-essential. Basic function of phenylalanine is to get converted to tyrosine, and this tyrosine is responsible to synthesize different hormones such as epinephrine, norepinephrine, dopamine, thyroid hormones such as T3 and T4 and melanin. And this tyrosine can also be called is responsible to synthesize glucose and also fat. Since it is able to synthesize glucose, it is called glucogenic, and since it is able to synthesize fat, it is called as ketogenic, as ketone bodies are required for fat synthesis. So we'll just see how the conversion actually is from phenylalanine to tyrosine. Let me draw the structure again of phenylalanine. This is CH COOH NH2. This is phenylalanine. Okay, since it will be in the body due to acids and all, it gets protonated and therefore it gets a positive charge. Okay, this one in the body due to different fluids and different acids, it gets protonated and get a positive charge, and here instead of hydrogen I'll put it as minus. So phenylalanine, just phenylalanine, okay, you can put hydrogen also if required. Okay, this one in presence of it undergoes hydroxylation. Okay, hydro, that means OH gets added. So hydroxylase will be the enzyme, and the compound is phenylalanine. So phenylalanine hydroxylase, and what happens to the aromatic ring? OH gets attached and everything will be similar. What happens, how are we getting OH? That will be the question. What happens is oxygen, the molecular oxygen is taken, and during this process there is another enzyme called biopterin. Okay, this biopterin in tetrahydroform. Okay, tetrahydro means there won't be any double bonds, 4 hydrogens are present. This tetrahydrobiopterin gives two protons from it. As a result, it forms water molecule. This tetrahydrobiopterin gives two hydrogens to this oxygen molecule and forms H2O, water molecule. And since it has given two hydrogens to the oxygen, it retains two more hydrogens. So this will be dihydrobiopterin. Okay, and this dihydrobiopterin gets converted to tetrahydrobiopterin in presence of reductase enzyme. Dihydrobiopterin gets converted to tetrahydrobiopterin in presence of reductase. So the enzyme, you can call it as dihydrobiopterin reductase. During this process, since it is a reduction, NADH plus H plus gets taken up, okay, and gives out NAD plus. Okay, this is the actual conversion of phenylalanine into tyrosine. Okay, we'll just do a recap again. Phenyl, this is alanine group attached to it, phenyl, so phenylalanine in presence of phenylalanine hydroxylase takes up the oxygen molecule and the hydrogens from tetrahydrobiopterin and forms water molecule, and this one retains two protons. As a result, it forms dihydrobiopterin. This dihydrobiopterin gets converted to tetrahydrobiopterin in presence of reductase, that is dihydrobiopterin reductase. During this process, since it is a reduction, it needs NADPH and H+ and gives out NAD+. As a result, at the fourth position of the benzene ring, there will be a OH gets substituted. Okay, so this is tyrosine. This is the conversion of phenylalanine to tyrosine. I hope you have understood what the introduction part is. If you want any more information, or if you want me to elaborate something more briefly, do let me know. I shall make the video as soon as possible for your convenience. Okay.